Okay. So dry spells and the dark nights of the soul. There's a story that's told of a farm couple who were driving along in a pickup truck. And the wife said, "We never sit all snuggled up in the truck like we used to." The husband thought for a moment, looked over at her, and replied, "I'm not the one who moved." And when we discover as individual believers or even as a church that we aren't as close to God as we once were, we need to understand something. He didn't move. We did. And what is a person to do when they realize that they have moved away from God, that there's no more, and I'll explain what I mean by dry spells and dark night of the soul here in a few moments, but that there's no more passion or the seeming power of God in our lives, no hunger for his touch, no desire for his truth, no sense of his close presence. In most cases, we're still going through the religious motions, but no sense of God's direction or blessing directly on our lives. And that can often happen because our hearts become hardened either through the circumstances of life or because of sin. And do you want to know two things that are unequivocally true today? Every human being born under Adam, in Adam, has sin and has sorrow. Everyone. There's none righteous, no, not one. Right? Every person alive, who's ever been alive, has had sin, apart from Christ, has had sin and sorrow. You know, the Bible says all have sinned. There was a preacher who was preaching on this theme once, and he asked if anyone, it was one of those hyperbole questions, those questions that really didn't have an answer, if anyone had ever heard of a perfect person. And a man in the back raised his hand and said, "I don't know him, but I've heard a lot about him. It's my wife's first husband." But all have sinned. And then all have sorrow. Every person has sorrow. Not everybody talks about their sorrow. Not everybody deals with it the same way. But when you start digging into families, you start digging into lives, everyone has experienced sorrow. This sin and sorrow has brought soul devastation that in themselves they cannot fix or solve, but Christ can. So I was just thinking about this and came up with the title Dry Spells and Dark Nights of the Soul. What I mean by dry spells are those times where our hearts, as the song said, our prayers are old, our hearts are hard, there's a coldness to our life, and there's just a lack of seeming response, emotional response, heart response to the things of God. And when our hearts are just hurting. The dark night of the soul, as the Puritans called it, can be described as a spiritual crisis. Typically for a believer in the dark night of the soul, the Puritans would talk of this a lot. Typically for a believer in the dark night of the soul, spiritual discipline such as prayer and consistent, devotional time has lost its experiential value. What I mean experiential value is that you don't feel different after having been in the Word. Traditional prayer is difficult and unrewarding. This is how they would describe the dark night of the soul. And it goes on for an extended period. That's why it's called the dark night of the soul. It's a period where your heart is just not feeling and you're struggling in your faith. And the individual may feel as though God has suddenly abandoned them or that his or her prayer life has collapsed. So I want to ask you some diagnostic questions to see if you've ever experienced a dry spell or what I would call the dark night, or the Puritans would call the dark night of the soul. Have you ever had a season of your life where inspiring biblical truths just simply didn't move you? Where you would hear a rousing sermon and others are being moved, or to tears, or are being changed by it, and you just kind of thought it was only okay. Where truths that one at one point, maybe you go back to an old passage that meant something to you 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago, it rocked your world, and now you read it again, and you're just like, meh. it doesn't have that same impact. So have you ever had a season of your life where inspiring biblical truth simply didn't move you? Next question. When knowing what God commanded you to do or not to do, when it didn't seem like enough motivation. Does that make sense? That question makes sense? When you want to do something that the Bible tells you not to, that God commanding you not to just doesn't seem enough to cause you to not want to do it. Third question, diagnostic question, if you've ever experienced the dark night of the soul. When praying felt like you were simply praying to the air. When Bible reading seemed like an incredible chore. Like anything would seem easier than reading the Bible at that moment. When reaching out to God still made you feel like you were all alone. When looking for satisfaction, you kept choosing every place in your life except the Lord, and then found no satisfaction. Depending on how you answer those questions will probably tell you if you're in the dark night of the soul right now. I will say this, and this might be very, very, very disillusioning for people. Pastors go through dark nights of the soul. There are times when, a matter of fact, some of the anecdotal, experiential bullet statements I'm going to end with come directly out of my own struggle to fight through the dark nights of the soul. Times where we're discouraged, times where we just simply aren't moved by spiritual things, times where we are just feeling abandoned and struggling in our faith. So what I want to do is I want to, and this is, like I said, very general. There's so many different directions you can go with this. Well, where does this spiritual depression come from? Sometimes we're going to talk about in general, but a whole lesson could be on it can be the result of sin. It's not always the result of sin, but sometimes we feel this way because we have sinned. other times because great suffering has happened in our life, and there is a struggle. There is a kind of maybe even an unconscious disillusionment for how God is supposed to work in our lives as believers. All kinds of reasons for how this can happen. But I want to take you to Matthew chapter 11, a simple passage for weary spiritual travelers. And we're going to read this, talk about it, and then we're going to end on one more passage. So in Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 through 30, Jesus offers a basic invitation. Here it is. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Really, in this passage, there's two simple things. This isn't a deep outline. This is a simple outline you'd find anywhere. There's a basic invitation and there's a basic promise. There's an invitation and there's a promise. And the invitation is this: Jesus invites all who are weary and burdened to come to him. And people who are going through dry spells, they're weary and they're burdened. People who are going through the dark night of the soul, they are weary and they are burdened. And what I find oftentimes during the dark night of the souls is that we go every place but to the right place. I might tell an accountability partner what kind of struggles I'm having. I might go to a John Piper book. And both places are good, but they're not ultimate. They're not first. They're not the main place. I might have a moment where I'm introspective into my life to ask myself, what's wrong with you, Mike? Why do you feel this way? And that's a place that, certainly, you know, can be helpful if you don't stay there too long. I think the problem with a lot of times people become poisoned by their own heart because our heart is desperately wicked, right? Who can know it? And so when you're too introspective for too long, you're literally lingering in a place of poison. You know, so we got to look, we don't look within ourselves to find hope and healing. I mean, sometimes it's good to go, what am I sensing? What am I feeling? What's going on? It can be helpful to be introspective, but that's not the ultimate place you go to. Self-healing, self-awareness has a very small place, but that's not ultimately where we land. So all these places we tend to go, tell a friend, read a book, search my heart, there are places you can go, but they're not the ultimate place you can go. Where should we go? To the Lord. He invites all weary and burdened, all who are weary and burdened, to come to him. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. It's a personal invitation to come. And it's a safe place. You know, here's the thing about Jesus. Jesus did not come to judge. He came to deliver us from judgment. Now, how many times are you afraid to tell a friend what you're feeling, what you're thinking, what you've done? Because you know before they probably give you some help, there's going to be some judgment, right? There's going to be some I told you so's and how could you let this happen to you and a host of other things before we get to the mercy. But there's rest. The nature of the person who comes is a wearied person, a burdened person, one who's laboring, one who's heavy laden, one who's loaded down with burdens. And so I just love this passage. It reminds me, where do I go when I'm spiritually dry? And here's the tendency. The tendency is when we're spiritually dry, to know that we're spiritually dry because we've sinned, because we've not handled suffering well, because we've gotten bitter. And so it's hard to want to look the person we've sinned against in the face. So how many times have we run farther away from our source of healing because we simply don't want to face the one we've sinned against? And I think that's true in life. Some people would rather not have their relationships resolved than have to face the one they've sinned against. And so we see that there's this basic invitation for us to come. But then there's a basic promise. Jesus promises rest to all who come. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart. So there's a basic promise. Jesus promises rest to all who come to him, truly trusting in him for all that he is and all that he does. There's just imagine some scenarios where rest is needed. Maybe you're along a hike in the woods, maybe a mountain, or you're walking. Let's say you're walking in the mall, and your feet are tired, your back is aching, you're out of breath, you need a drink. There's this big flat rock or a strategically placed bench, and you see it, you can't wait to get there, right? You rest. Or you're in a sporting event, you're on the court or on the field, and you're hot, you're sweaty, you're thirsty, you're exhausted, and finally the coach calls your name. I can remember in a basketball game, this was kind of a different era. You know, nowadays they're far more aware of the physical problems that can come through exhaustion and lack of thirst. I remember when I was playing basketball in high school. I doubt my high school coach will be watching this. But in conditioning, he'd make us run till someone threw up. And then he would learn who the people with the weak stomachs were. And then we'd have to run till someone other than, you know, that guy throws up. And in games, you couldn't call yourself out of a game. I mean, that would be the ultimate. Like, you couldn't say, I need a breather. Like, he'd pull you out when he wanted to pull you out. And so, but when you got pulled out, you were exhausted. When you get to quit running, when you have been running miles, and trying to make yourself throw up, but you can't. You know, those things. Try and take one for the team. When you finally get to stop, when you finally get some drinks, then just that sense of rest, that sense of refreshment, that's what Jesus is offering. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Now, remember what a yoke was? What was a yoke? It was something that that they put on oxen, on animals, that would pull heavy loads. It gives the connotation of the discipline of discipleship. Jesus is not offering, he's not offering a hard burden, but he's also not offering any responsibilities. When we come to Christ, there is a yoke, there is a connection to Christ, there is work to be done, but his yoke is easy. And his burden is light. And Jesus, the one who offers us to come to him and find rest for a weary soul, for those dark nights of the soul, he is gentle and lowly in heart. We find rest for our souls in Christ. So I want to go to one other passage. I want you to turn to, so we totally take another, we're just taking a turn here. So turn to Revelation. So the first thing I guess I want to say, I told you this is going to be very general, and then I'll decide if I'm going to go any further with this with more specifics. When we feel dry, when we're going through the dark night of the soul, our tendency is to run from Christ because we realize we're not right. But he is offering us to come to him. This tender, lowly, gentle Savior is calling us to come. Now, the reason I wanted you to look in Revelation chapter 2, verses 1 through 7 is because it's the first church in the church of the seven churches that John was given special inspiration from the Lord when he was exiled on the island of Patmos to send letters to. And they would be circulated letters, and many would see them. But in this letter, it's the first one of them, and it goes to the church at Ephesus. We know about the church of Ephesus. Paul preached in and spent a lot of time in Ephesus. We have the book, his letter to the Ephesians, this church in Ephesus. But I want you to read what it says in verses 2, 1 through 7. To the angel of the church in Ephesus write, the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand, who walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know your works, your toil, your patience, your patient endurance, and how you cannot bear with those who are evil, but have tested those who call themselves apostles and are not, and found themselves apostles and are not, and found them to be false. I know you are enduring patiently and bearing up for my name's sake, and you have not grown weary. So what he's done, what we see at first in this passage is we see, first of all, we see this compliment to the church. There's a compliment to the church. Actually, first we get the character of Christ. Then we get a compliment from Christ. And then the next, this church gets a criticism. And the criticism is in verse 4. And this is kind of what I want you to look at. But I have this against you. You have abandoned the love you had at first. Or one version says, your first love. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do the works you did at first. And then he's going to have a very, very strong warning. There's a call to repentance, a command to hear and heed, and there's a commitment. There's a whole lot going on here. But what I want you to see is verses 4 and 5, but I have this against you, that you have abandoned the love you had at first. Remember, therefore, from where you have fallen, repent and do the works you did at first. Let me get back to my notes here. This church, its basic problem There's a lot of good things going on. They're fighting for the word. They're fighting for accuracy. They're fighting for the inerrancy of Scripture. They're fighting to make sure that people are handling the word of God rightly. But what has happened is their hearts have grown cold. They are going through a dry spell. How do I know? Because they've lost their love. They've lost their first love. They're doing religious things. They're doing everything that people would look at and go, they're great Christians. But the one thing that God, who peers into our hearts, knows is going on is their hearts are dry. If they're going through a dark night of the soul, they have lost their motivation. They're doing this because they've learned how. Because this is a habit. This is a ritual. They're doing what they know to be true, but there's no passion, no desire, no motivation. There's no love. They have lost their first love. And a lot of times when we're going through these dry spells, when we're going through the dark night of the soul, motivation can be a problem. Have any of you ever been around toddlers, maybe your own or grandchildren? Maybe you've babysitted some. Take a little child, for instance. Your toddler is supposed to take out his empty cereal bowl to the sink, but he doesn't want to. Or you've asked her to change her clothes, but she doesn't want to. They flop on the ground and they cry, and they express the fact that they're too tired to do what you asked. On further investigation, they inform you that they cannot move. They'll try to convince you by faking that they're trying to move but cannot move. They're just too tired. Their legs won't work right now. Of course, if the ice cream truck pulled up to the curb with its music blaring, they would jump to their feet and move as fast as an Olympic sprinter, right? Why? Because it's an issue of motivation. Motivation can be a problem. Take that same toddler, give them another 10, 12 years, and they're teenagers now. And you ask them to cut the grass or to clean their room or to do their homework, but they're too tired to do it. They have done the minimal job that's just pathetic and terrible, and yet they have the energy to call a friend and hang out at the mall, right? How can they do that? How do they have the energy to go to the mall or to go to Cedar Point or to go get dinner at their favorite restaurant? Because it's an issue of motivation. Motivation is often the problem when it comes to our dry spells. So what about us? So motivation doesn't just affect children and teenagers. We have motivational issues. It's easy to complain about where we are spiritually than to do something about it. It's easier to fall into a feelings of being a victim to our circumstances or a victim to our sin or a victim to our emotions than to do something about it. That's why I like that song and wanted us to sing that song by Keith Green. My eyes are dry, my faith is old, my heart is hard, my prayers are cold. But then he says, what can be done? What can be done? And so what's interesting in this passage is Jesus has this against them, that they have abandoned their first love. Now, what's interesting is his anecdote, his answer for their problem. First of all, remember from where you have fallen. The first thing is to remember your life, your spiritual life when it was vibrant. To remember what you did, how you felt, how you responded, how the word of God moved you. And then to repent. And we know what repent means. It means a turnaround. It means a change of heart that leads to a change of action. And then, this is an interesting thing, do the works that you did at first. Do the works that you did at first. And I think that's interesting. Because even when the heart can't feel, do the right thing, even when the heart doesn't want to, and the whole time you're doing the right thing, pray that God would cause your heart to follow suit. He doesn't say, wait till you have your love back. Remember, repent, and do the deeds that you did when you loved me. And I think it's a very interesting thing. It's interesting that his command to solve the loss of love is to do the deeds they did at first. Now, only God can make a heart feel what it should feel, right? We say that so often. What do you do when your heart doesn't want what it should want? You ask God to change your heart. Only God can make a heart feel what it should feel, but there are certain things that we can do to put ourselves in what I call the place of grace or the path of blessing. Like, you can't make yourself feel something, but what you can do is, he's telling them, you know, you've lost your first love. But he doesn't say just sit in a room and be introspective until you get it back. No, he says, remember, then repent, and then do the things that you were doing. And so I think it's an interesting thing. We can't make our heart feel something, but we can place our lives, put ourselves in the place of grace, in the path of blessing. So what do I do? What should you do? And this is where we're going to end, practical. I have thought possibly that we'll actually just take these topics one at a time, some of these topics that we're going to talk about. But what are some very specific things that you can do when you're really struggling with your love? You're really struggling with the dryness of a heart. And the first thing I would say is enter a season of what I would call boot camp or basic training. Now, you can't live this way forever, but for a season in your life, you can, to get centered. The first thing that I would say is identify and distance yourself from some of the lazy, unhealthy practices and habits that you have formed as of late. So you go, Scripture doesn't move me. I don't even really want to go to church. I know I should feel bad about my sin, but I hardly do, and I feel bad that I don't, type of thing. You just know that you're in a bad place. The first thing I would say is identify how long this has been going on, and then identify and distance yourself from some of the lazy and unhealthy practices and habits that you have formed as of late. What are some things that you have been doing that may have placed you in this position? Another thing I would say is go on an internet fast and a radio fast. Now, why do I say that? I would say that for this reason, and this is something that I have done in these seasons of my life. I limit the sources that bombard me with secular perspectives. So I try to stay off of Facebook unless I'm using it solely for ministerial purposes. Who posted that they're having a surgery? Who posted that their mom is sick? Those types of things. But don't go to Facebook, social media. Stay away from online articles before reaching out to God. Here's how I say it. Identify in your life what devotions you are doing. Like, there are times where I would realize the first thing I do when I woke up was grab my phone and read the latest morning article on 11 Warriors about Ohio State football. And it dawned on me one time. I do my Ohio State devotions before I ever do anything else. And I said, that is an unhealthy practice. Like, that is unhealthy. Like, what do you do first in the morning? In a sense, a lot of times we have secular devotions. I mean, that might not, you might go, I don't like the way you say that. But I feel like the first thing on my heart, the first thing on my mind is to find out, you know, the latest on the Buckeyes. That, I thought to myself, that is my morning devotions. Like, so, two things. Identify and distance yourself from some of the lazy and unhealthy practices and habits that you've been forming as of late that may be a source of why you're going through a dry spell. Second of all, try to do an internet fast or a radio fast. The whole goal is trying to limit the sources that are bombarding you with secular perspectives that are stealing a spiritual perspective from you. like I said, you can't live this way, but what you can do is you can use this as a season of centering. Third, very simple, read the scriptures daily, even when you don't want to, even when you don't get anything out of it, even if you don't think you believe it. Just read it. Read the scriptures daily. Now, fourth, I would say pray daily, but I don't want to say pray daily. I'm going to say pray often, because daily is not enough. Pray often. In that season of boot camp or that season of basic training, every time you have a thought, every time you have a worry, every time you have something to rejoice about, just check in with the Lord. Just check in. Oh, my goodness, how are we going to handle this, Lord? What should I do? Oh, my goodness, praise the Lord. Thank you. Thank you. That went really well, you know. And just check in with the Lord. Pray often. I've already kind of hit this one, but here's a new one. Look within a bit, but look above a lot. Like, we're in this new age of healing comes from within. You just, even in churches, I think we've bought this lie. I think introspection can be good to kind of go, what is going on in my life that would make me do that, say that, think that, act that way, be that kind of person? But being introspective for too long, as I already told you, you know, the heart is desperately wicked. So if all I'm doing is hanging out with my own heart, then I'm eating my own poison. So look within a bit during these seasons. Man, what are you thinking? What's going on? What's going on in your head and your life? What hurts are you holding on to? But look within a bit. Look above a lot. So ask a close friend to give you an honest perspective of what they're seeing as of late. Now, most of you won't do that one because you don't really want to know what they're seeing. Not the friend that loves to step on your face. Not the friend that always one-ups you, but an honest, humble person who is a spiritual person who's humble, who would, if you give them permission and coax them a bit, will be honest with you. Not so they can hurt you, harm you, or, you know, use you as a stepping stone, but someone who really loves you. Ask a close friend to give you an honest perspective of what they're seeing. That can be helpful. And then, if you do that, put tape on your mouth while they're talking to you. Because I know from practical experience, every time I ask them to tell me what they're seeing, and I have an excuse and a reason and want to interrupt them constantly to explain why, just ask them. Put tape on your mouth and listen. Because what you're going to want to do is you ask for it, but you really don't want it. And then you start telling them why you do what you do. Just ask them, put tape on your mouth, and listen. Meditate next. Meditate on the scriptures or a devotional book or a Christian book. So you're replacing some of your social media outlets for a while. What are you going to put in their place? Meditate on the scripture. Get a devotional book, some Christian book. And then begin asking yourself some questions. So when you are introspective a bit, look above a lot, look within a bit. So when you're looking within, ask some very strategic questions. Ask this question: has some tragic event or difficult season skewed my perspective and view of God in any way? Like, what has there been some tragic event or a difficult season that even unconsciously has skewed my view of God in any way? Like, maybe deep down I'm mad at him, or I think he owes me an apology, which God never, ever owes you apology. For God to owe you apology meant that God has done something wrong. And if God has done something wrong, he is not God. but ask that question, because deep down you may be angry, unrighteously angry with God. So has there been some tragic event, difficult season that skewed my perspective and view of God anyway? Next question, when you are looking within, is there some unrepented habitual sin that has found its way in my life? Like, I'm going through a dark night of the soul, but the main reason is because there is an unchecked sin that has had its way as of late. Ask that question. Ask this question. Am I loving the world more than God? Am I loving the world more than God? And then, last question, is there an idol that has stolen my devotion and my worship as of late? Do I love the Buckeyes more than I love God right now? And you have to be honest with yourself, because you're going to say, well, of course not. Well, you're doing your devotions every morning in the Buckeyes. That's a start, right? Am I loving my spouse more than God? Am I loving my children more than God? Am I loving security more than God? Am I loving money more than God? Guys tend to make idols out of money and their popularity, what people think of them. And women tend to make idols out of security, like secure at any cost. And you can make an idol. That can become what you worship, is security, is money, is popularity, is your children, your spouse. So is there an idol that has stolen my devotion that I have been worshiping as of late? So when you do look within, ask good questions. Ask yourself good questions. When you look within, ask yourself good questions. So I'm going to leave it. That's the end of our devotion for tonight. I'll speak with the Lord and see if I want to hammer on this a little bit more, maybe get specific into some areas. And I might bring a book list of some resources that you can look to if you're struggling in this area. But let's pray, and we'll say goodbye to our worshipers from home. Father, we love you. We're so thankful for your blessing. I ask that this devotion would be encouraging to those who have been a part of it tonight. May you use it in the way that only you can. As many of the things that I've said and scriptures that I've looked to have been sources of healing and help and a strategy that I've used when I walk through these seasons of dry spells of these dark nights of the soul. May you bring comfort and healing to your people. In Jesus' name, amen.